Republican leadership, juvenile justice, child care, and South Dakota newspapers. From SDPB, today is Wednesday, March 6th, and this is In the Moment, Statehouse. Coming up this hour, we'll check in with longtime Senator Lee Schoenbeck about the waning hours of the legislative session and his leadership role in the state Senate. We'll also talk with the Pennington County State's Attorney's Office on how a bill headed to the governor's desk could increase use of juvenile diversion programs for counties. Plus, we'll speak with one of our Dakota political junkies about a bill he supported that recently became law. Jonathan Ellis will dive into what defines a newspaper in South Dakota. We're broadcasting live today from SDPB's Kirby Family Studio in Sioux Falls. I'm Jackie Hendry, in for Lori Walsh. You're in the moment. News is first.
This is SDPB News. U.S. Senator John Thune is entering the race to be the next Republican leader of the U.S. Senate. This comes after Senator Mitch McConnell announced he'll step away from the post in November. Thune is currently the number two Senate Republican. In an interview with Kelloland News, Thune said he hopes to be the next leader and will do everything he can to convince his colleagues to support him. He also told Dakota News Now that McConnell stepping down is, quote, a chance for a reset, and he'd like to be part of it. His announcement sets up an expected race with Texas Senator John Cornyn. Cornyn held the number two leadership post until he was term limited 5 years ago. A state senator is facing disciplinary action after giving a bottle of syrup to another lawmaker. Republican Senator Tom Pischke of Del Rapids is barred from the House of Representatives. Pischke co-authored a commemoration recognizing Nancy Green, a former slave who was the model for the Aunt Jemima syrup corporate logo. The company recently rebranded over concerns the logo was racially insensitive. The commemoration claimed Green was erased from history. Republican Representative Kristen Conzett objected to the commemoration, effectively killing it. A bottle of syrup later showed up on Conzett's desk. Pischke admits to putting it there. House Speaker Hugh Bartle sent a letter to Pischke saying the act violated ethics standards and banned him from the House. Pischke says he has apologized to Conzett. Public defense reform has made it out of the State House with the passage of House Bill 1057. This comes after months of study, discussion, and negotiation among lawmakers, lawyers, and judges across South Dakota. SDPB's CJ Keene has more.
The bill establishes a statewide indigent defense commission focused on the issue from a statewide level. Indigent means a person who cannot afford to pay for their own legal services. Currently, public defense services are handled on a county-by-county basis. Canton Republican Senator Jim Bolin worked closely on the issue. He says it's a success to get this bill on the governor's desk.
All of this came together in House Bill 1057, which established this commission and also added an additional one-time spending of $3 million to begin to help counties pay for the defense of individuals who cannot afford their own attorney.
Bolin says public defense in the state was no small undertaking.
Wasn't exactly what we wanted, but we got most of what we wanted. I'm very pleased by the results of the effort that came not from myself alone or from any person alone, but by the work of the summer study project and a lot of work by different senators and representatives.
One proposal backed by Bolin, the reallocation of a percentage of wholesale alcohol sales taxes to fund the commission, died in committee. He says the funding problem isn't solved yet.
Well, it will begin to help counties pay for this extra expense that has grown dramatically. This has to be the first step, and I know the Chief Justice believes this as well. This has to be the first step. We have to continue this as we go forward in years to come. It's not going to solve every problem, but it's a very major first step.
South Dakota has only three dedicated county public defender offices, and the commission will remove much of the pressure and cost burden from local to state taxpayers. I'm SDPB's CJ Keene in Pierre.
Construction on Highway 385 in the Black Hills this year will reduce access to recreation facilities at Pactola Reservoir. The recreation area just west of Rapid City will see closures or changes to access starting May 20th. To see the full list of impacted facilities and how to navigate around the construction later this spring, check out our website at sdpb.org/news. With your news digest, I'm SDPB's Ryan Bozer. Coming up on In the Moment Statehouse, now that the end of the 2024 legislative session is in sight, get a recap on the last few months and what's still left to do. Your 2024 session summary is up after the break.
On the next Radio Lab, a man is inspired to make a video game about a very personal tragedy.
That's not a game, and no one will want to play that.
All I have is my disappointment.
Who wants to spend their leisure time reliving the worst moment of a man's life?
But the game was much more than just tragic.
I was not prepared for the beauty of this.
It felt so much like mercy.
That's next time on Radio Lab.
Listen Saturday at noon Central, 11 a.m. Mountain.
Program funding and support for SDPB legislative coverage is provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges. More information at SouthDakotaBarFoundation.com.
For some combat veterans, the 4th of July is the toughest day of the year.
The loud noise is associated with something horrific and dangerous. And now any unpredictable loud noise can create the same response, whether it's a slamming door or fireworks.
How fear hijacks our minds, this week on Hidden Brain from NPR.
Listen Saturday afternoon at 1 Central, noon Mountain on SDPB.
Support for SDPB comes from SDN Communications. If your data is outgrowing your business, you can rely on the team at SDN Communications to boost your bandwidth in no time. Enjoy the uptime. More at SDNCommunications.com.
You're on In the Moment at Statehouse on SDPB. I'm Jackie Hendry, in today for Lori Walsh. Tomorrow is the last official day of the 2024 legislative session. And ahead of that deadline, we're going to get another political news roundup from our very own Lee Strubinger. Lee is our politics and public policy reporter and joins us now from the SDPB studio in the Capitol building in Pierre. Lee Strubinger, thanks for stepping away from the dance long enough to give us an update. Welcome back.
Yeah, of course. I'm not nervous at all that the Senate and House are gaveled in and I'm here talking to you, but we'll catch up.
Well, based on, you know, your last known facts of the matter, what are some of the items that you're still watching play out?
Yeah, so earlier this morning we saw both chambers sort of meet and talk about these three different bills that deal with regulating carbon pipelines passing through the state, whether it's regulating easements or payments to landowners and some of those other ideas that have really, I think, defined this particular legislative session. It's kind of been the big issue there. They've sort of came to agreement on those, and both chambers will be weighing in on those, you know, at any moment. We also have a sort of look at the kind of funding formula for teacher pay when it comes to increases in education funding, and they're also making some changes to the formula and what the average needs to be of that percentage increase that goes directly towards teacher salaries. And so again, that's another large issue that has really defined this session right from the outset. It was something that Governor Noem talked about during her State of the State speech. A little bit earlier, there was some discussion about how to regulate children's access to pornography on the internet. And that is something that a lot of people expect to be really an ongoing discussion moving into the summer and going forward. And beyond that, we have some discussions about funding for infrastructure improvements at airport terminals and expansion and some of those ideas. So those are kind of the big ones that are hanging out there right now.
Right. Lee, all of these stories you just mentioned are stories that we've covered on SDPB. These are things that can change minute by minute in these kind of waning hours of the legislative session, so folks can stay up to date with that at sdpb.org/news. But Lee, in your coverage of the State House, I know, for instance, last session there was the conversation about various tax cuts or tax holidays, and the one chamber had a very different vision from another chamber. And I'm wondering if that's a similar thing that we're seeing this session or not so much. Talk to me about where some of those maybe differences on some of those items have been shaking out.
Well, that's going to be a really big issue going forward. I mean, this is a temporary tax cut. There have been efforts to make that particular tax cut permanent. But if you'll keep in mind, there are efforts to place removing the food tax from the ability of the state to tax food and some of those other items, placing that into the state constitution. And what that will result in is, we'll have a few years where we'll have this temporary tax cut, and if it passes, this kind of temporary or this permanent tax cut on food. But you've got to keep in mind that the state is facing, a lot of expenses going forward. We heard this morning that some Republican leaders are concerned about what cutting that food tax will mean for those teacher salaries going forward. Another concern that is out there is the cost for Medicaid expansion. So if the voters, the voters said they want Medicaid expansion, but then if they come back and say, we want to cut this particular tax as well, that's money that lawmakers are using to help fund Medicaid expansion. You know, there are a lot of priorities that lawmakers have really laid out, Republican lawmakers, Republican and Democrat, who one of those priorities being a pause in or a freeze in tuition for those attending our tech schools and our state universities. That's a priority that they would like to see continue going forward because they're seeing a lot of results with that. But when it comes to the dollars that are available to make that happen, when we're talking about tax cuts and those other things, those are some of the kind of tangible things that would be affected if those were to come to pass.
Right. And Lee, before we wrap up, obviously a lot of those funding issues play out in the budget. Just kind of walk us through that procedural piece in these closing hours of the session for folks who might be new to following this process and a little confused about how things are moving back and forth. Give us just a summary of what's actually happening, what people can watch online, what people can't watch online, and how that shakes out.
Yeah, so if you really want to watch how the budget gets put together, you can go to SDNet and listen or watch Joint Appropriations. But basically the big idea is that they're adjusting the current fiscal year, which runs through the end of June, fiscal year 24, and then they're also setting fiscal year 25. And this year in particular, they have $41 million extra dollars in fiscal year 24 to put towards what they hope to be just kind of these one-time projects, one-time payments, typically infrastructure related. A lot of that, a lot of the idea being that money will go towards the two massive prison projects that the state has been putting money away for years to help pay down. And then for fiscal year 25, they came back after the governor's budget address in December and realized they have $21 million extra that they can work with. And so they're kind of figuring out what they want that money to go towards. One of the big discussions, budget items, if you will, that get negotiated right at the end is what kind of money goes to this group that's called the Big Three, which is state employee salaries, it'd be education funding, and Medicaid provider funding as well. And what they're looking at this year in particular is doing a 4% increase across the board, which, in prior years, that's been anywhere from 6 to 7%. When you take a look at sort of the way inflation and revenues coming in sort of post-pandemic, those were kind of outliers. But, one thing that Republican leaders stressed this morning during press conferences is that 4% is a lot larger than what we've seen outside of these particular outlier years. Typically, those increases have been around 2 or 3%. So 4%, they're really proud of being able to make that happen. And it sounds like something that is on the table.
Right. You can watch live streams of Gavel to Gavel coverage online at sd.net. Up-to-date news coverage, sdpb.org/news. In the meantime, SDPB's politics public policy reporter, Lee Strubinger, get back to it. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Jackie.
The new SDPB podcast, Short Walk, is now available. It's a 9-episode series, and it chronicles the political saga of former South Dakota Attorney General Jason Roundsburg. He struck and killed pedestrian Joe Beaver in 2020, and Roundsburg was impeached and removed from office in 2022. The podcast is produced by SDPB's politics and public policy reporter, Lee Strubinger. You can download it wherever you get your podcasts, or at sdpb.org/shortwalk. So South Dakota State Senator Lee Schoenbeck has been a familiar face around the state capitol in Pierre for years now. He's a leader in the state Republican Party and joins us now to discuss his leadership and mentorship in the Senate and beyond. Senator Lee Schoenbeck is with us from SDPB's studio in the Capitol building in Pierre. Senator Schoenbeck, welcome to In the Moment. Thank you for joining us.
Well, Jackie, I'm happy to be here with you. What do you want to talk about?
Oh, I want to talk about so many things. So let's start with your perspective. We just heard from Lee Strubinger. We're in the final hours, busy time. What do you see in summary as some of the big wins for South Dakotans this year?
Okay, well, first, I got to tell you, if your listeners haven't heard Lee Strubinger's band, that's something you got to take in.
I was supposed to be there, and I'm still salty that I missed it. So
I was there last week. He's really good. I'm old. I only spent an hour, but it was fantastic. You know, big issues from this session, I would highlight, I mean, there are a lot of important things that are done. The biggest thing every year is doing the general bill, and which funds all of state government and much of local government. But I probably pick out three things that might not be readily apparent to folks. Let me take K-12 funding first. Back in the day, people always talked about, well, whatever leftover money we had, that's how we decided what we were going to do for state aid education. That process has gotten a lot more formalized, and and it's been good that on the front end in December, and for sure by January, the school districts start having an idea, a pretty good idea about how things are going to turn out. And so that process continued this year with the 4% increase, and I don't think there are any bumps in that road. I also would point out the higher education, which now includes both technical colleges and the regential universities. The relationship, while I've been in Pierre, it's a sea change from back in 95 when they were fighting all the time to now where we have a legislature that has a high sense of how important those institutions are to the future of our state. For job recruiting people to South Dakota, recruiting jobs, creating opportunities. That change that happened over the last 10 years. And by the way, I give Dana Dykhouse probably the credit of more than anybody in South Dakota for making that happen. Mm. But he worked with both sides and kind of beat both sides up about getting together. And now, there I mean both sides, as in the technical colleges and the regential universities, now they cooperate. And because of that, the relationship with the legislature is hugely improved. So this year, again, for the third year, we had a tuition freeze. That's a big deal, particularly about recruiting people from other states to come to South Dakota, to our technical college and our regional universities. And we retain a huge percentage of those people that come here for school. So it's a big economic development driver. Probably the third big thing is the continuation of the project that Governor Noem started. Got years run together here, but I think it was 2 years ago. The prison funding, that's a big deal. Mm. That's been kicked down the can by governors for 50 years. The current prison was created in the century before the last century. And, you know, there have been some things discovered since then, like electricity and all kinds of other novel things. So having a new prison that will keep our community safe, because if you don't, what you're going to get is, you let it deteriorate too bad, and we're there on the women's prison already, they're going to have federal judges, as it's happened in California and other places, requiring you to release those prisoners because it's inhumane to treat anybody that way. And now with these new facilities, our communities are going to be safer because the people that we have determined aren't safe to have in the community are going to be held.
Technology evolves over time, policy tries to keep up, and that's my sort of clumsy transition to get us to talk about the summer study or interim study being floated around appropriate ways to mitigate children's access to online pornography. This is a subject that came out through one of the bills this legislative session. Talk to me about where that conversation sits and maybe some of the other topics that are being floated for interim studies this year.
Well, that topic's a great one because, first, everybody feels we ought to find a way to deal with child pornography on the internet. The challenge isn't the will. The challenge is to find a method that works. Mm. And you can pass a law that says, we think it's bad and we're outlawing it and we're going to have authority to sue you if you're doing it. But to an internet provider in China, that doesn't mean anything. And in fact, I think it's been ineffective in the places that have tried it. Here's what we don't know as a legislator. Here's the knowledge base we lack, and it affects more than just child pornography. We don't know what part of the internet regulation space we can effectively as legislators regulate. And so one of the important things the summer study would do, and we could utilize the Attorney General's office and their task force, Dakota State University with their internet people, and there are plenty of other entities that are willing to participate that care about this, on mechanically, what can the legislature do to act in this space, because these are not South Dakota pornography providers. I mean, the old debates 20 years ago were about people selling pornography in bookstores in South Dakota. That's not the discussion. Now it's people overseas that are putting stuff on the internet that kids are accessing, and the ways to get at that may not be just, well, they certainly aren't just passing a law saying we think it's bad. It's going to involve what kind of filters devices might be required to have in South Dakota that kids have access to. There are a number of different things. But also, if the legislature gets that knowledge base about how can you act in this space, it affects more than child pornography. It affects their ability to look at artificial intelligence and regulating that, because I just was at a deal last year, and I think the speaker made a great point that artificial intelligence and that being used in political campaigns and ads that are put on television and on the internet will probably be the most destabilizing thing that politics in America has ever seen, because you can create somebody's face and have them giving a speech they never gave, taking a position they never took, and the public won't know what's true and what's false. So learning how to regulate in that space is important, and then cybersecurity, same issue. We need to know what can we and what can't we do. So if this summer study, if we can educate, I'm not coming back, but those legislators are coming back, if we can arm them with knowledge about where they can act and where they can't act effectively, that's a powerful, good thing to do.
Hmm. Well, you just said it, you're not coming back. Talk to us about how you weigh some of those decisions, because you've been in and out of the legislature for decades now. Obviously, this is a draw to you. You've been elected by your fellow lawmakers to the top-ranking position in the Senate. Talk to us, reflect on that a bit for us.
I was just telling Lee Strubinger that I was the first legislator to use a laptop in 95 when I brought mine. And there was no such thing as wireless internet in those days. There was barely cell phone coverage. In fact, there wasn't in the building. But so this time, well, actually, when I ran and got elected, so I've been in and out four times. There are two of us in the history of South Dakota that have done that. The other guy was because he kept getting beat. Me, I get motivated to come. I think as a citizen legislator, if there's something I care about, or if life circumstances, you have four kids at home, and your wife says, don't you think you should be helping here? there are any of those number of things that make you relook at it and say, okay, it's time to take time off. My wife said to me as I was driving in on Sunday night, I was talking on the phone, and she said that I'd gotten real good about leaving the legislature. I just hadn't figured out yet how to stay out. this time, a little anecdote for you. So I ran in 2018 because I was not happy with somebody who had been serving in our Senate seat from Watertown. And I win. And in January, my wife, I'm home on the weekend. We have a large master bath, a mirror on each side. I'm at my mirror. She's at her mirror. And she says to me, just turns around and says, how long are you going to do this? And I thought it was a quick answer. I said, just two more elections. Now, you know you're in a political family when your wife's next response is to immediately convert that to, that's five more years. To which I said, sounds like a lot when you say it that way. Those 5 years are up this year. So that, got to keep your word.
That's right. You're known as a mentoring figure for a lot of new lawmakers as they come in. Are these people seeking you out? Are you seeking them out? Talk about your role there.
Well, it's a little of both. A lot of that starts in the candidate recruitment when you're out trying to find good people who are respected in their communities to run. but then once you get here, or they get here, you see who seems to have the, a friend of mine, Brent Hoffman, he always heard that Schoenbeck was in the early days, they called me a right-wing nut, and then they moved the wing on me. And now I get called a rhino all the time. And Brent pointed out to me after about a year of serving together, he says, you know, I figured out what it is, what matters to you with legislators. I said, what's that? Apparently, I say this all the time. I didn't realize it until he told me. I care about who's a workhorse. I care a lot less about whether they agree or disagree with me on some issue as to whether they're willing to do the work to figure out how to make good laws that we can pass through the legislature. And when you get to see people, and it doesn't take very long, you're here a month and you're going to know that's a person who's going to work hard. That's a person who, if you mentored them a little bit, they might be able to get there. And then you can see the ones that they're never going to, they're going to be chewing their crayons the whole time they're here. So, I mean, you pick them out. And then the ones you try, in leadership, you try and create opportunities. Mm-hmm. I've been appointed to chair a standing committee. Even though for 6 years I've been here, I've been the person that makes those appointments. I always said I could never convince myself I was good enough. But if you don't do that, if you don't take a committee, that means you create one more committee chairmanship that you can put one more new legislator in. And again, creating opportunities for leadership.
Yeah. As we wrap up, Senator, I want to ask you about kind of your thoughts on the political future of South Dakota and these younger lawmakers that are coming up and young folks who are deciding to run for office. I know you have at least one in your own family, but we can talk more generally speaking about what you foresee for those folks and maybe advice you would give for people who are considering running for office.
I think the advice I'd give them is you need to run because you care about the future of the state. You can't be motivated by any one issue or any narrow perspective. And then you got to go out and prove in your community that you're somebody that's got good judgment. You're going to make 2,000 votes during a term. People can't know how you're going to vote on every one of them, but they got to know if you sound like the person that would exercise the judgment they would do when you're here. That's what I try and tell people. I think there's a lot of young people who want to be involved. I look at Katie Washnuck running for the Senate up in Aberdeen with my son Jake down in Sioux Falls. Amber Holsmith, South Dakota, running out in the Black Hills, and all the way across the state. There's just a lot of younger people. So one day I'm driving to work last year to the Capitol. I call it going to work. And I called my wife up. We're talking on the phone, and I told her, I said, you know what? It's just time. I'm plugging the system up. You have to move aside to create opportunities for these young people. And if you give them opportunities, they'll flourish.
We've been talking with Senator Lee Schoenbeck, longtime Republican leader serving in the South Dakota Senate. Senator Schoenbeck, a pleasure talking with you. Thanks again for joining us.
Take care, Jackie. Bye.
Coming up next, Jonathan Ellis with the Dakota Scout returns to the show as our Dakota Political Junkie. You're on In the Moment, Statehouse on SDPB.
You may have noticed that car washes are popping up everywhere these days, and the owners are cleaning up, literally and figuratively.
Industry estimates suggest a car wash can make about $1.5 million in annual revenue, and so that has created a flood of investment interest in opening and expanding car wash franchises.
What makes car washes so lucrative? On All Things Considered from NPR News.
Listen this afternoon, beginning at 3 Central, 2 Mountain on SDPB.
Program funding is provided by the Sanford Underground Research Facility, supporting South Dakota teachers and students with classroom resources, field trips, and professional development. Learn more at sanfordlab.org.
I'm Carl Gerke, and this evening on Jazz Nightly, we'll hear the latest from Kansas City trombonist Brian Scarborough and Denver trombonist Zach Rich. Also, the Black Arts Jazz Collective, featuring saxophonist Wayne Escoffrey and trumpeter Jeremy Pelt, plus classic tracks by John Coltrane, Charles Mingus, and Chick Corea. You can join me at 8 Central, 7 Mountain, here on SDPB Radio.
Program funding and support for SDPB legislative coverage is provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges. More information at SouthDakotaBarFoundation.com. Politics and Public Policy Reporting is supported by the Center for Western Studies at Augustana University.
Welcome back to In the Moment, Statehouse on SDPB. I'm Jackie Hendry, in for Lori Walsh. One of the bills signed into law by the governor this session is Senate Bill 75. That bill, now law, changes the legal definition of a newspaper in South Dakota. And this law affects publications like the Dakota Scout, which was one of the bill's supporters. And we've talked with Jonathan Ellis about this bill before, but we're checking back in on his thoughts now that the bill is really and truly law and over the last final legislative hurdles. So Jonathan Ellis is the co-founder of the Dakota Scout and joins me in SDPB's Kirby Family Studio in Sioux Falls. How you doing?
Good, Jackie. Very good. Or hey, I mean, you know, we're getting near the end of the legislative session, right? I mean, we heard Lee talk about some of the stuff going on, and I really enjoyed the interview with Senator Schoenbeck. A lot of institutional knowledge. But yeah, the bill, but Senate Bill 75 was signed by the governor a couple weeks ago, so that will become officially on the books July 1.
Right. And I think you've touched on this in previous conversations with Lori, but I'm just imagining from a journalist perspective, you're so used to covering how the sausage gets made, and then you step up to the plate.
And we had to, I had to learn how to, you know, how the microphone on the committee hearings work. And anyway, it's kind of a daunting process, actually. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm used to public speaking and so forth. But I had some nerves testifying.
Yeah. So how does this new law impact the Dakota Scout and other publications like you?
Well, the newspaper legals, and for people who don't quite get what those are, those are like meeting minutes and things like that, and legal issues that come up that are that require public notice. And those laws have basically been on the books really unchanged since the 1980s. And I think it's not a mystery to everybody that the newspaper industry has changed quite a bit. Especially in the last few years compared to the 1980s. And so different business models are emerging. And our particular business model is not one that would have qualified as a legal newspaper under the old law. The reason being is that the newspaper industry had excluded freely distributed newspapers. We're an advertiser-supported newspaper, and we give it out free. The newspaper industry had good cause, I think, back in then to have those restrictions because they didn't want just advertising shoppers to then get legal notices. And to be, again, in full disclosure, I mean, the local governments have to pay the newspapers to publish those legal notices. So there's a revenue stream for the newspapers who publish those. And so we did get that changed so that freely distributed newspapers would qualify. You know, there's some provisions in there that you know, you have to meet in terms of having content requirements of covering local news. There were some other provisions in there that you have to have an office within the county that you're in, you know, brick and mortar office. And so there's some provision and there are requirements, of course, on, you know, you have to have a certain number of copies and a certain number of online subscribers because part of this is an online subscriber element as well.
Mm-hmm. So now that that's across the finish line, what else are you watching in the Statehouse as we're wrapping up?
Well, and we talked about this, but I mean, obviously the big thing is going to be, I mean, some teacher funding issues for sure. The big thing though will be, the carbon pipeline issues. Mm-hmm. You know, we wrote about this last night that this kind of emerging consensus or, you know, compromise package that's coming forth, it's not going to make everybody happy. Compromises never do. You've seen some of the opponents to the pipelines be kind of central players in trying to get some of this stuff compromised. Landowner Bill of Rights, the sponsors of this say that this will have the most protections of any state in South Dakota, in the United States. We are our own state, and so there's a lot of provisions in this. It's a three bill package, and it provides some revenues for counties and things like that, but. Yeah, there are some. I should say another key things in my view is that it requires these pipelines to be a foot deeper than federal standards, and there's also some transparency. And one of the issues that a lot of the opponents are concerned about are the sort of leak modeling, and so it requires that leak modeling be disclosed to the public, which I think that's a good point for transparency. So there's a lot in it, but it does sort of preempt some of the county regulations that have been put in place in a few counties.
Right, and that was going to be my question, kind of the things that get left on the table in a compromise. You know, that's why. Those are not always satisfactory to everybody, but what are some of the kind of things that might be left on the table if the compromise sits, you know, as it currently sits at this moment in time, could change even more in the next few hours?
Yeah, it could change. Obviously, I think that the big hurdle will be in the House. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there'll be issues about the eminent domain. There'll be, you know, currently, carbon pipelines qualify for eminent domain in state law, and efforts to remove them in the last two sessions have failed. There'll be, you know, I suppose, questions about greater oversight by the PUC and what's their role going to, you know, they have a role in this, but there's some provisions in the package, but you know, that talks about their greater role in this too. So a lot of this will be hashed out, and I'm sure there are some counties who are going to be upset about the preemption. But I've talked to some county commissioners too, who are like, kind of, they're, you know, they warned before the legislative session that this is going to happen. I mean, every time counties go in, you know, crazy quilt work of different regulations, the industries, whatever the industry is. I mean, you can look at large scale, you know, confinement operations on the ag side. The state has stepped in and said, look, you can't do. You know, they've tried to regulate uniformly. So this was not a surprise to some county commissioners that have been more in favor of working with pipeline companies.
Yeah. Turning away from the legislative session to the national scene, big news, Mitch McConnell announcing stepping away from Senate majority leadership position, opening the door, presumptively, maybe not so presumptively, for South Dakota's own John Thune. What are we looking at? What would that mean for South Dakota if,
you know,
that pans out?
It's a stature kind of position. It means that obviously Senator Thune is working within that conference to, you know, establish where they're going in terms of policy. You know, the leadership posts, I think, were in some sense were a bigger deal a few decades ago, because you had the ability to direct more sort of pork funding to states, and that's not as big a deal as it once was. I mean, I recall back in, you know, 20 years ago, you get press releases from, you know, Senate offices outlining all the spending projects we brought to you, you know, in a certain bill, and that's not something you see anymore, because it's, you know, pork has become kind of a dirty word there. And so, but I mean, it carries a lot of stature. You set the policies going forward for the entire conference, and I mean, it can't be bad for South Dakota if he's the leader.
Mm-hmm. Does this seem like a high likelihood that that's going to be the next step, or are there challengers? I haven't quite noticed that.
Yeah, there will be challengers, and it's a question of, and I wrote about this, and I actually didn't, this is kind of something I left on the cutting room floor that I didn't have in my story, but I asked Senator Thune about what's different about the Republican conference, Senate conference now, than it was when he entered office in 2005, and of course, mm-hmm. he said it's, you know, it's more populist, and a question of whether or not, but you know, but his point is it's still the party of small government, and the question will come about is whether or not the party conference has moved in a way that maybe is beyond, you know, outside of where Senator Thune is. You know, Thune has been, you know, again, I you know, he's a conservative, but he's also been one of these, you know, willing to, you know, practice, you know, to govern. I mean, he's not, you know, some in Congress don't want to actually govern. They want to try to force, you know, their will and get what they want. Mm-hmm. And that's not always, and that's never really possible. And so I think Republicans and Thune and McConnell have been criticized because they've been willing to cut deals. And I think they would say, well, yeah, we cut deals, but we also get conservative victories within those deals. So so I don't know if the conference is where the conference is at with regard to Senator Thune. Now, I know he's worked very well with his colleagues. There are other, they call them the three Johns, John Brasso and Cornyn, who are also considered potential contenders in that. But Thune is the number two. He's very well liked within the conference. So I would think he would have probably a leg up in that race.
My guest has been Jonathan Ellis, co-founder of the Dakota Scout and our Dakota Political Junkie, for today's conversation. Jonathan, thanks for joining us.
I'm happy to be here.
Coming up after the break, the Pennington County State's Attorney's Office joins the show to talk juvenile diversion programs. You're on In the Moment, Statehouse on SDPB.
I'm Peter O'Dowd. Ukraine's second largest city, Kharkiv, has been under renewed Russian shelling recently, prompting President Zelensky to say the city isn't safe enough for residents to return. We'll get the latest from inside Kharkiv, near the Russian border, next time on Here and Now.
Listen Wednesday afternoon at 1 Central, noon Mountain, on SDPB.
Funding for SDPB comes from the South Dakota Humanities Council, celebrating literature, promoting civil conversation, and telling the stories that define our state. Learn more at sdhumanities.org.
Are you a sports fan in South Dakota? Do you enjoy talking about the good old days when it comes to reliving your favorite moments? Check out the hottest sports history podcast in the Mount Rushmore State, In Play, with me, Craig Maddock. Throughout the past 3 years, we've featured many iconic names and teams from South Dakota. Subscribe to In Play with Craig Maddock today. Wherever you find your podcast, the conversations are endless.
Sponsored by Horton Incorporated of Britain.
Support for SDPB comes from SDN Communications. If your data is outgrowing your business, you can rely on the team at SDN Communications to boost your bandwidth in no time. Enjoy the uptime. More at sdncommunications.com.
You're listening to In the Moment, Statehouse on SDPB. I'm Jackie Hendry, in today for Lori Walsh. One of the greatest predictors of adult incarceration is youth incarceration. That's according to the Director of Youth Services with the State Department of Corrections during a recent testimony on a bill related to juvenile diversion services. That bill is currently awaiting the governor's signature. Juvenile diversion programs can help young people understand consequences of their actions and equip them with the tools they need to make better choices and to address the root causes of some of that poor behavior. Here to help explain the program and give us a closer look is Kim Moresching. Kim is the Director of Juvenile Diversion in Pennington County and joins us now by Zoom. Kim, welcome to In the Moment. Thank you for taking time for us today. I'm not sure if I can hear Kim, so we're going to continue with Senate Bill 47, which is an act to revise the incentive program as a way to incentivize counties to take advantage of the juvenile diversion program. We're working to make sure that we can get audio from Kim Moresching, who is the Director of Juvenile Diversion Services with the Pennington County State's Attorney's Office. While we're working on sorting out some of that technical issue, I want to bring to your attention on tomorrow's In the Moment, we're broadcasting the first two episodes of SDPB's Short Walk podcast. And it sounds like we have Kim Moresching on the program. Kim, welcome to In the Moment. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much for the invitation.
So the state's attorney's office, the Pennington County State's Attorney's Office, Laura Retzel, the state's attorney there, testified in favor of Senate Bill 47, which revises the incentive program for counties to take advantage of these programs. That bill, again, is awaiting the governor's signature. And I wondered if you could explain for our audience how a bill like this, which increases some of that funding for counties, will impact your office and how some of that programming plays out.
Absolutely. So Senate Bill 47 is designed to increase the funding given to counties. That is an opportunity to help subsidize diversion for our county so that the entire amount doesn't fall onto the county's shoulders. Right now, our county is kind enough to invest strongly in diversion, and this would allow us to offset that for the county. Counties are almost solely responsible for diversion programs, unlike probation, Department of Corrections that are funded by the state. So this allows that to happen. And we're blessed in Pennington County that we have a county commission that is interested in investing in that, but smaller counties or more rural counties that don't have the funding, this will allow those diversion programs to grow.
Yeah. So outline for folks who might not be familiar with what exactly a diversion program looks like. What does that look like? What kinds of behaviors might make a young person eligible for a program like that?
So in diversion, we accept any kind of substance charges. And I would say that this is based on the specifics of that charge. So tobacco charges and alcohol charges, marijuana charges, fighting at school, theft charges, and And then what we try to do is tailor that diversion contract to work with that individual, repair damage to an individual. If there's a victim involved, we want to repair that damage, repair damage to the communities. Anytime we break laws in our communities, we damage our communities. And then also get services to that young person.
Mm-hmm. I wonder if you can break down some of the numbers for us. So, for instance, last week your office released, the state's attorney's office, I should say, released the 2023 annual report for Pennington County showing, I think it was 669 youth diversion cases with a fairly high successful completion rate. What does success look like for young people that move through programs like this?
Success looks like we engage in a conversation with youth and families to address their charges. So we always want to be respectful of challenges that they may have going on in their life. Once they we agree to what they will do to address their charges, they would complete that in a timeline. And once they complete it successfully, then we dismiss the charge.
Okay. And so part of the incentive or, I guess, benefit of these diversion programs is it keeps lesser offenses or young people who commit lesser offenses out of juvenile detention, for instance. Do I have that kind of, am I tracking with kind of the benefits of a program like this?
Yes. It also, for juveniles, it keeps them out of the court system.
Mm. So what are some of the trends that we're seeing for Pennington County in some of these youth offenses? Are numbers trending up, down? What kinds of offenses?
We actually trended down a little bit this past year. I think we're seeing a lot of the general things that we already see and we've seen for a few years, tobacco and alcohol, marijuana charges. We do see more vaping of marijuana, and of course more vaping in general. You know, there's always, I would say the disorderly conducts at school, which is mostly about young people becoming dysregulated. Mm. So we try to look at those individuals and provide stability or stabilizing programs.
Mm-hmm. I've heard concern in some conversations that maybe diversion programs aren't harsh enough, or that, say, if the example is shoplifting, and maybe the root cause of shoplifting isn't at issue with diversion, but it might be the issue for the business owner. How do you respond to folks who are maybe skeptical of some of these programmings?
I think one of the things that is concerning to the general public is that they're concerned that we're diverting really much higher level dangerous crimes. And I think it's really important to know that the vast majority of young people that are offered diversion have either never been in trouble before or have pretty low level charges. And I think that I don't know that we have a lot of proof that being harsh with juveniles is exactly what they need. What we need are diversionary programs. You make better choices when you know better. And so that's what we try to provide, is access to those programs. The way to stop drinking is to learn about what drinking does to your body so that you can make more informed decisions. There's also, I think it's really important to know that if you fail in diversion, your case will be sent back to an attorney who could send it to court. So failure in diversion does not mean that you have no consequences. Hmm. It means that you now have a different path. And I think that's important for our communities to know too.
Yeah. And I want to take the chance to ask you about the mural program that I'm blanking on the title of exactly right now, but I know the state's attorney's office received a grant to further this. Talk to us about that program and how that sets young people up with mentorship and a different way to maybe process some of what they're going through.
Yes, so we're so lucky. We have this wonderful JUMP program, which is a mural program that we do through our Dahl Fine Arts Center and young people. And it's in also a combination with our juvenile Western South Dakota Juvenile Services Center. So young people in the Juvenile Services Center create an idea and put it on a large scale canvas. And they do that like in 3 days, and then it gets moved over to the Doll Fine Arts Center, where diversion young juveniles come in and bring life to that, adding color, adding different design elements. We've done something similar to this in the past, and we had remarkable results. Art reaches young people on a different level and helps them process sometimes traumas or decision-making or peer pressure or any of the kind of challenges that face our young people today. And there's also an art therapist involved who helps young people go through their thoughts and feelings. And it's amazing. Young people, to call yourself or to be involved in an art program really is kind of scary. Like I don't know how to draw. It feels risky to young people, but almost 100% of them, when we complete the project after 2 weeks, they are so proud and they're excited about pursuing art. So it also gives young people something else to do, some other way to channel their activities.
Our guest has been Kim Moresching. Kim is the Director of Juvenile Diversion for the Pennington County State's Attorney's Office. She joined us by Zoom. Kim, thank you again for your time. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
In the Moment Statehouse is broadcast live on SDPB Wednesdays at noon Central, 11 Mountain during the legislative session. You can hear the rebroadcast on SDPB Radio at 7 p.m. Central, 6 Mountain. For updates on these news stories and the latest from Peer, tune in to Morning Edition and All Things Considered on SDPB Radio and online at sdpb.org/news. You're listening to In the Moment Statehouse. I'm Jackie Hendry, and joining me now in the Kirby Family Studio in Sioux Falls is Kayla Klein. Kayla is the director of Early Learner South Dakota, an initiative looking at access to quality learning and more recently childcare throughout South Dakota. And we're going to close the hour with an update on some of the childcare questions moving through the State House and what we can look forward to. Kayla Klein, welcome to In the Moment. Thanks for being here.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
So the last time I saw you was in Peer testifying in favor of a cost analysis study related to childcare. This was brought by Senator Tim Reed out of Brookings. We do have some of an update on how that bill has played out. You're welcome to kind of update listeners on what we're looking at as far as that cost analysis study goes.
Yes. So I think the biggest thing for everyone to take away is that we had a huge success in the legislative session this year. So that's what I want everyone to know. I know there was some concern like, oh, the bill was dropped. Does that mean that it didn't go through? Nope. So what ended up happening is Senator Reed and the Department of Social Services were able to talk with each other, and the Department of Social Services does some work around this already, and what they were able to do is agree to expand some of the work they already had planned that would essentially meet the needs of what we were what Senator Reed was requesting in Senate Bill 125. Mm-hmm. So it's, and the big difference is looking at, there is generally a narrow cost analysis that's done within the Department of Social Services, but we wanted to see more of a cost modeling study, which just dives so much deeper and gets really kind of into the weeds compared to what has been done in the past.
Right. And what would be the benefits of getting some of that information?
Well, the thing is we don't have the information we need to make wise data-driven decisions. So we really want to understand, what is it if providers were able to pay their employees a living wage, if they were able to offer them benefits, if they were able to have all of the quality materials they needed to have a high-quality program that any child could access in South Dakota, how much does that actually cost? Because what we know is that providers aren't charging what it actually takes for them to run a program and meet all of those things. Right, childcare is the second lowest paid industry in South Dakota. Mm. And so what does it take for us to have high quality programs? And we need that information. And we also need to know how many spots do we need now? Do we need maybe 5 years, 10 years from now? And we're going to be looking a little bit more at the unregulated sector as well, which has never really been looked at too much before in the past. And that's huge because that's a 60% of the market in South Dakota right now is unregulated providers. And we want to make sure we understand what is it that we have the capacity to serve now versus how much we're going to need. Mm-hmm. And this study should be able to give us some of that information.
Right. I know one reason that the bill was brought forth initially, and again for listeners, that bill has been tabled because an agreement was reached with the Department of Social Services that made the bill pretty much moot. So the Department of Social Services is looking into the information that was proposed in that bill. But that bill came with a deadline for when that information would be released. Yes. And I'm not sure if you can answer this question for me, but I'm wondering if that's also been part of the conversations with DSS or if we have a hard date for when we can look forward to some of that info.
I definitely might get in trouble if I say a hard date.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't want to promise anyone anything, but I will say that from what I understand, the conversations that have happened between the Senator, other legislators, and the department is that results will come out before the end of the year.
Before the end of the year. That's something to look forward to.
Yes,
before the end of the
that's
year.
That's huge.
A big update as far as the information around childcare. Kayla, in the last minute and a half or so, I know I believe you're also involved with Senator Tim Reid's kind of ad hoc task force looking at childcare, a statewide look, because so much of this has been happening in pockets and communities and not an overarching look at some of the issues. So what do people need to know about those conversations and kind of what's next as we look forward to some of that information at the end of the year?
Right. Well, the task force has been great. We have quite the array of individuals from across South Dakota. Every corner of South Dakota are going to be participating. The Hunt Institute is going to be facilitating those conversations. The first step of that process was for them to do some funding and asset mapping, which is currently taking place. And then there's going to be four primary meetings that will happen between now and October. And those conversations will lead to even more information with the data and asset mapping. And now on top of that, hopefully we'll be able to even include some of the study findings in our task force conversations. That will really help us prepare for looking at the full picture and what childcare, what the true crisis looks like, the data behind it, and maybe how can we move forward with admin and rule changes. And maybe what's going to happen in the next legislative session.
My guest has been Kayla Klein, Director of Early Learner South Dakota, with an update on childcare research in South Dakota. Thank you for your time. Thanks to all of our guests, and thank you for listening.
SDPB brings you the South Dakota Girls State Basketball Tournament. You can catch all the action Thursday, March 7th through Saturday, March 9th. For more information, including the multiple ways to watch the games live, go to sdpb.org/basketball.